I welcome you one and all to the Asian American Asian Research Institute's Conference on Education, Challenges and Perspectives. I'm Professor Emeritus Betty Song, formerly on the faculty and chair of the Department of Asian Studies at the City College of New York. First, let me give you a little background of our institute. The institute was founded, which I will refer to it as IRI because it's a shorter, something shorter to pronounce. We came into existence only a year and a half ago, only 2 months after 9/11. Although Asian American faculty at the City University had clamored for this institute for many years, but you can imagine what happened to our promised funding from the university right after 9/11. In spite of this, due to the unswerving dedication of our executive director, Dr. Thomas Tam, the tall fellow, where is he? We have chalked up a very impressive record of accomplishments. The first thing we did was to galvanize the academic community, the Asian American community, and the government to come together and address the question of rebuilding Chinatown, a community that has been severely impacted by 9/11. Our conference was held in this very building on May 10, 2002. Over 300 conferees attended. The speakers and panelists were able to highlight the economic and social impact inflicted upon Chinatown and to recommend solutions. It was an unprecedented meeting of the minds. Proceedings of the conference were published and disseminated. The mission of IRI is to serve as a university-wide scholarly research and resource center that focuses on the policies and issues that affect Asians and Asian Americans. As an institute of the City University of New York, we can tap into the expertise of faculty in Asian and American and Asian American studies of the 20 campuses of the university system. Each year, over 24,000 Asian American students are enrolled in the City University colleges. In addition to our very successful conference, Dr. Tam has provided a forum for scholars and community leaders to address issues of Asian and or American, Asian American concerns. A weekly lecture of a series of lectures has been given, and even though you might not be able to be present at the lectures in person, you can view the lecture at your leisure on your home computer by a process called webcasting. Dr. Tam has made full use of the modern technology by disseminating our activities on a website at www.iri.info. So if you want to access any lecture, you can log on. This year, IRI has awarded 5 research grants to our faculty, and they will be making presentations of their research at this conference. Now, our theme for this conference is Asian American Education, Challenges and Perspectives. And we're honored today to have some ranking officials of the New York City Department of Education speaking to us. And please stay for these lectures because it will be very informative. One will be Vice Chancellor of Education, Dr. Diane Lam, and Superintendent of Programs and School Improvements, Ronald Wu. Commissioner Betty Wu is going to represent the Mayor, Mayor Bloomberg. And among our speakers will be Dr. Nicholas Michelli, Dean of Education at City University, Vice Chancellor Otis Hill, Vice President of Queens College, Joe Shelsa, the Honorable John Liu, our City Councilman, the Honorable Judge, Darsman Cohen, Dean of Students Frank Shi of the Queens College Law School, and Dean Erwin Wong from Borough Manhattan Community College. I can't name all of the distinguished faculty and speakers who are going to participate in this conference because it took too long, and we're thankful that they're here today. I was speaking to Superintendent Ron Wu a few days ago, and he tantalizingly dropped a few bombshells about what's happening with Asian American educated students in the New York City public schools. I pressed him to tell me more, but he said, I'll save that for my remarks at the conference. So with the range and expertise of our participants, I'm sure this conference will bring out a great deal about a state of education with Asian Americans that will give us much food for thought. And now let me present my co-presider, Dr. David Chang, Director of the Counseling Center at Baruch College.
David. Hi, I'm David Chang. Welcome to Baruch again. It's very strange. It feels like a deja vu feeling. It seems like only yesterday that I was standing right here, and around this time, like 8:45, 9 o'clock, welcome you to Baruch for the first RE conference. So here I am again, welcoming you to the second annual RE conference. Somebody asked, is it going to be a tradition? Do we have more? I think that we have to talk to Tom about that, right? In any case, we had so much has happened, although it only feels like yesterday that we were here, but so much has happened in the past year that I think the conference today is really very timely. As an Asian or Asian American, I really think that we have a lot of challenges nowadays. For instance, I think just coming here, being an Asian, you can probably get a seat on the train very quickly as long as you start to cough or sneeze. So I think that many of you have a lot of issues and questions and things that you are interested about the community and about being Asian and Asian American research hopefully will be addressed today. And may I remind you that this afternoon would be a chance for you to speak up. As Dr. Song has said that in the morning you will be listening to all the important people talking, but in the afternoon perhaps will be an opportunity where there will be a dialogue and you will be in smaller groups and you can ask questions and perhaps have a dialogue between you and the other people that share similar interests about particular issues that you are interested in today. Once again, I have the opportunity of introducing our president to you, our president, Ned Regan, who really needs no introduction. He was very well known and well respected long before he became the president of Baruch College. He was the New York State Comptroller for 14 years, and we all knew a lot about him. And in the past year that he's been here, he has done so much for Baruch College that we're really all proud and respectful and glad that have him here again today to be our first speaker. So, President Regan.
Thank you very much.
I'd just like to play a brief role just to say thank you all for coming to this marvelous building. I know as Queens College President Jim Muyskens, who I'm sure everybody here knows, and I was just talking to you, you had to kind of walk. This is a high-tech building, but the only way we keep the doors open is a low-tech way, and we have to put plastic waste baskets so that you can walk in. But if you ignore a few of those things, this is a marvelous building. We hope you walk around and take a peek at it and just imagine what it does for teaching and learning, because it does allow for interaction, spontaneous interaction between student and student, faculty and faculty, and importantly, faculty and student, which is the important thing. It allows for that and encourages. It's kind of like stacked quadrangles, Jim. That's what we call it, where you pick up that tradition of the college campus, but do it in an urban setting. My only concluding remark, other than to welcome you, is to pick up on something David just said, and Betty said earlier, there's 24,000 Asian students, and obviously you gathered my background is public. There's 24,000 Asian students. The last thing I did who live in somebody's Assembly District, New York State Assembly District, somebody's New York State Senate District, and somebody's City Council District. We all know John Luke, but other than that. And that is power. That's power. And the last thing I did before I got here was to read the Assembly and Senate bill. It's on the Assembly computer, New York State Assembly computer site, and CUNY takes it in the jaw again. And that means everybody in this room, as how the bill stands now. And the governor threatens to veto it, but there's nothing in there. They didn't increase our revenues. And a matter of fact, if you read it carefully, they kind of decreased our revenues, which is kind of consistent with where the governor's program is to not increase taxes. So while they're increasing taxes at the Assembly and the Senate, CUNY is not benefiting. In fact, it's just the reverse. So I am for, and Jim and I were talking about this earlier, a very active, participatory Asian American community. Lord knows we certainly have that to some extent. Not enough for, as far as I'm concerned, but to some extent at Baruch, with hundreds of Asian Americans here, and then of course an enormous number coming from overseas. So we have a very strong community, as David and others know. But for the Asian Americans, if we want to create a superb educational experience for our students and our colleagues and our friends and our community, there's a lot of ways of going about it. You can get the great professors, you can get a great building like this where this interaction occurs, and you can get funded. And you get funded by elected officials. And elected officials will pay attention if voters who live in their district, voters, not just people, voters who live in their district, write them a little postcard and simply say, fund CUNY the proper way, signed a voter, or something similar. So there's political power in this room. There's political power in the five boroughs. There's political power if you want to use it. And don't think that an institute that is designed around educational goals, being concerned about how you fund educational goals is something beneath us. It isn't. It's how we get here. And you've all got to help me and help Jim participate in this. And this is what it's called. We're called, you know, we're a democracy. Everybody's supposed to participate. And we'd like to see the real muscle that exists in the Asian American community come to work to help who? The very people that we're all in this room designed to help. So I thank you for coming here. Please enjoy this great building. Your taxes paid for it. All right. And your taxes that you pay are allocated by the elected officials that you elect, and they ought to spend it the way you want it spent. Thank you very much.
We're housed under Queens College, and President James Muyskens is president of Queens College. I'm going to keep all the introduction remarks very short because we want to keep on schedule. I know all of our speakers have very, very impressive credentials, very impressive records and achievements, but I'm going to try to keep the introductory remarks very short. We'd like to present President Muyskens, president of Queens College. He was formerly CEO and dean of faculty of the Gwinnett University Center in the University System of Georgia. He is a philosopher and special expert. He has special expertise in bioethics and the philosophy of religion. And he has more than 25 years of administrative experience. We're very honored that President Muyskens has come to address us. Thank you, President Muyskens.
Thank you very much. Certainly a pleasure to be here and to be at this college. It's great to follow President Regan. He said what I wanted to say, and he said it very eloquently. We have opportunities here, and to hear it from someone who's been a public official. So I'm going to say just a little more about that. But first, just to say it really is a pleasure to be here, and I want to recognize one person who's in the audience, one of our Board of Trustees members, Wellington Chen. I haven't seen him since 2 hours ago last night. I'm always gratified. I've been now in the university for 8 months after some years here years ago. The kind of support we get from the trustees, and I in particular from you, Wellington. So I appreciate your being here today and where we were last night. Appreciate all that you're doing for us in this tough year. As you know, the center, the institute, is located here in Manhattan, but it's affiliated with Queens College. And we're very, very proud of that and happy that that's the case. Queens College, as I think you all know, is located in Flushing. And that is the most vibrant Asian American community in the United States. I think our councilman would agree with that. So it's fitting that this institute is associated with the college. Our campus has students from nearly every country in Asia. And so we've always sought to highlight the issues of importance to the Asian community. Therefore, very much as President Regan said, we are eager to see the political clout of the community be enhanced, as well as what we're trying to do to raise the issues that a research institute deals with. We have many, many faculty on our own campus, but we want more and more to be involved in activities of the institute. Thomas Tam, who's doing a wonderful job with this center, and I've had a number of conversations where I think we're very hopeful we're going to be able to do a lot with tapping the resources we have so that, in fact, the sum of the whole is greater than the parts. As a new institute, only a year and a half old, you have certainly done remarkable things. And I commend you for that, and most notably the conference that's been mentioned, Healing and Rebuilding New York after 9/11. Now you may know I was not here in New York at that time when the conference took place, but I've read through the proceedings, the published proceedings, and they are packed with wonderful analyses of the problems that Asian Americans faced before and after the destruction of the Twin Towers. I must say that although reading the proceedings is very helpful in terms of what one learns, it's also a bit discouraging because, as you well know, and here I'm speaking to the choir, many of the problems that were brought on by 9/11 have yet to be addressed by local and by the federal government. Therefore, the work of this group and the work of the entire community clearly is there for us. We must continue to raise the visibility of the Asian American community, continue to demand that that voice is heard and that these problems are addressed. And that's what I, as president of Queens College, want to assist in, both with the many initiatives on our own campus in Queens and with the institute here in Manhattan. So today's conference is valuable in that respect, because I think it tells people that Asians are now a permanent part of the social and political landscape of New York. And I see from the program that you'll be addressing many of the problems that we at Queens College also are wrestling with every day, such as how to improve teaching of English to new immigrants. What forms of counseling will be the best, most effective for Asian students? So what I want to say, in addition to what my colleague President Baruch said about the importance of political involvement, is that we must do much more within our campuses to talk about those questions and be sure we address the unique issues that face the community. So collaboration is what we need. I think we're well on our way, but I want today to make it clear to all of you that I will do everything in my power as president to make sure that that collaboration strengthens. I'm very, very proud to be here today. I think this is an exciting conference. The list of speakers is truly impressive. So I congratulate all of you who put this together, and thank you for having me here today. Thanks.
Thank you very much, President Muyskens. And now our second speaker is John Liu. I don't think we need any introduction to John Liu. His name has already been mentioned. And if our fare goes into our subway fare, and bus fare goes into, increases tomorrow, the next day. John Liu has been working very hard to get that fare reversed. And he was the one that started the whole conversation going about the extra money in the MTA budget anyway. But we've always been very proud of John Liu. He's the first Asian American city councilman elected to that office. He's chair of the Transportation Committee, as I mentioned, a member of the Committee on Education, which is the topic that we're dealing with, consumer affairs, contract, oversight, and investigation, and the Lower Manhattan Redevelopment Project. The Honorable Liu has served as president of North Flushing Civic Association. He's a member of the Queens Community Board 7. He's vice president of the Queens Civic Congress, and he has also served as vice president of the New Century Democratic Association. Please welcome the Honorable John Liu.
Thank you very much, Professor Sun, for very generous introduction and comments. I want to thank you and Professor Cheng for once again presiding over this very prestigious conference that I know Dr. Thomas Tam has put a great deal of work into. And just a quick note before we talk about education, since you mentioned the subway system, we are doing whatever we can to restore accountability to the Metropolitan Transportation Authority, which actually bills itself to be the largest transportation agency this hemisphere. And millions of New Yorkers clearly rely on the services that the MTA provides, most basically to get to and from work or to and from school. And it is incumbent upon them to do the right thing, and in this case, simply to restore public confidence in what they're doing. And it turns out that Controller Hevesy, the state controller, put out a very detailed report on how this agency is not accountable and in fact has deceived the public. And actually, the Controller Hevesy testified at my hearing yesterday, and he gave a great deal of credit to his staff members who actually were discovered by the former controller, Ned Regan, a while back, two controllers ago. And of course, Ned Regan gave us some opening remarks just before, and so I want to thank him for finding the talent a number of years ago to make sure that we are now able to figure out exactly what's going on with the MTA. But I am very proud to be here once again to talk about issues that are very, very critical for the Asian American community and for New York City as a whole. I think what we try to do in this institute, and this institute has grown in size, in magnitude, and in the realm of issues that it covers. What we try to do is to make sure that the issues, the most relevant issues to the times are well covered. Last year, it was in the aftermath of September 11th, and I had an opportunity, while I wasn't able to stay the entire conference last year, I read through most of the transcripts, and it was amazing how much material was covered. And I have every confidence that during today's conference, just flipping through the program and taking a look at all of the different people who will be giving us their comments and sharing with us their insights, this is really going to be a groundbreaking conference of I think large proportions. And so I want to thank this institute, and I know Jim Muyskens, who's the president of what I consider my college, Queens College in Flushing, is very supportive of. There are a number of educational issues that really are going to be critical in the next month as the state budget gets resolved, and it may be resolved that quickly. I know that the state legislature has been meeting nearly nonstop trying to figure out a budget that will be workable for the residents of this state of New York, and that may or may not be with the blessing of our governor. The governor has clearly launched an all-out assault against public education in this state, and much of that assault is directed straight at the city of New York with his proposals to cut a vast amount of funding for our public institutions of higher education, as well as for public schools from secondary school down to pre-kindergarten. And the consequences of his cuts are going to be the death of the future of so many of our young people ranging from 4 to 24 and beyond that, because I think that the tuition increases that will arise if the governor's cuts go through, the tuition increases for CUNY and for CUNY students are going to be astronomical. And I don't think that the governor understands that $1,000 or $1,200 or maybe $1,500 a year is a tremendous burden for many of the students who rely on CUNY institutions and for that fact, CUNY institutions as well. President Muyskens and our other college presidents in Queens, Eduardo Marti and Gail Mellows and Russ Hotzler from York College, we had a meeting several weeks ago talking about how the cuts that the governor is proposing has a very leveraged effect on CUNY, on the CUNY system. And that is going to take away, not only will the students of CUNY have to pay much, much more for their tuition, but that will also force the colleges, even with those tuition levels, force the colleges to cut back on many of the vital services, instructional and otherwise, that students currently enjoy. And I know that the state legislature is restoring some of that money to our CUNY and CUNY schools, but nonetheless, it's not enough. It's clearly not enough. And of course, CUNY is so relevant to Asian Americans because as many new immigrants come to New York, CUNY often has been the place that they can go to for a quality education. CUNY has always had a tradition of being the institution that educated people of color, minority communities, and clearly we have a very, very large Asian American population in the CUNY system. So we really have to put the pressure on the governor to to understand the values and the contributions that CUNY provides to the state, to the city, and most importantly, to the community that we all belong to, the Asian American community and the immigrant community in general in New York City. The immigrant community is what keeps and what has kept New York City for centuries the leading city in this nation and a leading city in the world. And as far as the cuts to public education, $1.5 billion that the governor proposed in cuts to public schools all throughout the state, a little more than half of that affecting New York City public schools directly, the elimination of pre-kindergarten, the elimination of class size reduction programs, all of those cuts are going to be so detrimental to the kids at the most, at the earliest ages, where we're trying to set their educational foundation off on a very, very solid level. And these cuts are simply going to take away from our ability to do so. And so I think every one of us here, by being at this conference and talking about these issues, we will have an impact. And it's really important to send a message to the governor that these kinds of cuts will ultimately result in higher costs for the state and for the city. These cuts in public schools for New York City are going to really decimate the quality of education for our youngsters, and the Asian American population is the fastest rising group of kids that are in our public schools, especially at the early childhood levels. And I have a distinct personal interest in early childhood education because first of all, I'm proud to be a product of New York City public schools from kindergarten through 12th grade, and then I did go on to public college in New York. But now my own son, who's 2.5 years old, he's a year and a half away from pre-K. And now every night I go home and Jenny, my wife, asks me, have you put the money back in pre-K yet? And so I didn't tell her that I was coming to this conference today and talk about how we can get that funding back for this very important program. So that all of the kids in New York City and New York State can start off their schooling on the right footing, and also to make my wife happy. And the yellow light is just coming for Don. That means Professor Sun wants me to conclude. Thank you very much for having me this morning.
John Liu. Aren't we all proud of him? Not only
yes.
Does he want to maintain us to maintain the subway fare, but he's also fighting equally strongly to support our school system and our school budget. He's our first Asian American representative in city government, and I'm so glad that he has been such a strong voice. Thank you again, Congressman, City Councilman. Of the Indian Academics in America. And again, I'm going to abbreviate his long introductory and his background. He's a graduate from three continents. He received his undergraduate degree at the Punjab University in India. He went to Russia for his MS degree, and then he came to the United States for his doctorate at Penn State University. He's been professor of engineering and dean of engineering at the City College of New York, He is the founding president of the Society of Indian Academics in America. Professor Raj.
Thank you. My role here is, I have a double role to play. First, I'm a professor at City College of New York, and I'm part of the system.
Can't hear you.
And secondly, I connect 16,000 professors of Indian origin throughout the United States of America. And I'm very proud to be part of this intellectual group today. The education concept is not new to the Asian people. The only thing that happened is that our environment has changed. In the ancient times, some of the first universities in the world was founded and established in Asia only. And the concept was slightly different than what we have today. The earlier concepts were creating a total person with a balanced mind. And that involved 14 knowledges, which included knowledge about 7 intelligences, 6 philosophies of the universe, and the knowledge of God and so on. And these 14 knowledges were actually subdivision of only 2 knowledges. One is we call inner knowledge, which they call today biology, biomedical engineering, and plus spiritual knowledge. And the outer knowledge, which was time and space and materialistic knowledge. In all these knowledges were available at that time, and based on knowledges, they were dealing with inner knowledge, scaling like 10 to the power of minus 56. They were doing this unknowingly in those days, and embodying, collecting, acquiring the knowledge of that nature, which we, at present day, we're talking about only nanotechnology, which is only 10 to the power of minus 9. So you can figure out how the depth of knowledge existed and how the interpretations of this universe were taking place those times. And as early as 3,000 years before Christ, a learned scholar in India said, time and space do not exist. They are only perceptions of thought. And that concept has been proven only last century by Einstein, that at the speed of light, there's no distance between space and time. So you can see that this whole inner knowledge concept and the outer knowledge concept existed much earlier, and emphasis was being more on the inner knowledge, because they felt, the ancients of our scholars, they felt that the inner knowledge actually leads to the more accurate knowledge of the outer world. Similarly, a Chinese saint, Lao Tse, said about the ultimate truth that it cannot be said or written, but it can only be acquired. And what is the ultimate truth is really acquiring the knowledge which we are come to all the universities. The further, the concept was about teachers. Teachers were not just to teach. Teachers were to make their pupils in possession of themselves. That was the main idea. Unless that happened, that was the ancient concept, which again, here we go to the classroom, teach the students, give exams, and then we go home. The ancient scriptures also pointed out that it is only education that can lead you from darkness to light, and from unreal to real, and make you feel in the spirit of timeless, or get beyond the bounds of time. But how to acquire all this? That's the question. And it is said in practically every literature that, especially addressed to students now, that it is the sacrifice, what you make, and that is the key element in the acquiring the knowledge. I have recently done some research in this area, and I've collected 29 other assisting virtues which help in acquiring knowledge or what we call education. For example, absence of false pride, jealousy, deceit, doubting nature, nonviolence, education, service, self-control or discipline, duty, equal-mindedness, forgiveness, with respect to the teacher, to the parent, and so on and so forth. It is also said that the path of knowledge is required to accomplish anything. It has no weight, no luggage, no baggage to carry. Never lost, no matter wherever you go or where. The wise student, therefore, should be sophisticated enough to distinguish between, to see a action in inaction, and inaction in action, or this is that, and that is this, as Zen Kuti said. I'm very pleased to note the 7 topics you have chosen for today's conference and discussions. And incorporating the strength and heritage we have acquired from our ancestors free of cost and our wise men, we should strive to incorporate them in this land in our present education system. And this is the challenge I present to this conference. And once again, very proud to be part of this group and good luck in the conference.
Thank you very much, Professor Raj. And we're going to change the order of the speakers a little bit right now because Deputy Chancellor Diane Lam has to leave in a few minutes. And I'd like to introduce Deputy Chancellor Diane Lam. She is Deputy Chancellor, I think, to Joel Klein, right? The second ranking person in the Department of Education. And I was told also that, I think John Lou noticed the lights in the front here. The red light means, the yellow light is a warning, and the red light means that your time is up because we want to keep on schedule. So without further ado, let me introduce Deputy Chancellor Diane Lam.
Thank you. And hi, everyone. Thank you for changing the schedule. I'm actually involved in a two-day retreat in the IBM Center, and I just came so that I could address all of you here this morning. Now, last week, a film about violent Asian-American teenagers opened to considerable attention. Now, I have not seen that movie, Better Luck Tomorrow, but the tagline in its advertisements is what intrigues me, and it says, never underestimate an overachiever. Now, the publicity campaign does not actually show the teens overachieving, or even in school. It takes on faith that millions of potential moviegoers already connect Asian students with academic success. How odd, then, that the four words, never underestimate an overachiever, warned us not to sell short the depth and complexity of these teens' lives, even while that loaded term, overachiever, plays up sweeping generalizations. In some ways, many students of Asian ancestry really do surpass academic expectations. Though many are challenged by poverty and the disruption of recent immigration, Asian students have some of the highest test scores in reading scores in New York City, standardized tests. And their math proficiency rates stand nearly 5 times higher than the other students of color. Though these scores are relatively high, the majority of Asian students have yet to meet our city's rigorous proficiency benchmarks. Even students who soar academically continue to struggle in other ways. The August 2000 Child and Adolescent Social Work Journal finds that Asian American teens exhibit more depression and withdrawn behavior than do their white peers. Another study shows nearly 2/3 of Korean, Vietnamese, and Hmong students report that non-Asian students are mean to them. we have no choice but to look closely at the problem facing students of Asian heritage. But the very act of doing so gets at one of the oddities of school in America. The ethnic diversity in Asia, of Asia, is so incredible that a country as small as Laos is home to over 80 languages and dialects. However, as soon as new immigrants step on the plane at Kennedy Airport and go to register their children in school, their subtle ethnic differences meld into just one cultural designation, or relation. 60 years ago, most people in Korea and Japan could never have imagined that in America, their grandchildren would unite based on their cultural identity, similarity. We see what we hold in common, even as we hold onto the range of our differences, all the way from Assamese to Zhuang. Still, to most of the nation in which we live, we are monolithic. New York City, of course, could never be so simple. Researcher Sao Fong Siu notes that students whose parents are professionals from Hong Kong and students whose parents were laborers in the Chinese countryside are both Chinese, but their school experiences will be quite different. Obviously, a second generation kindergartner whose family owns its house in Bayside and a kindergartner who just moved from one school to Grand Street share Chinese heritage, but probably start school with very different needs and expectations. Given the enormous variety of ethnic, class, and school experience here, there is no way for New York City schools to address all Asian students' strengths and struggles. Instead, our curricular reforms aspire to a kind of diverse sameness in teaching. Some people have interpreted our citywide restructuring and common curriculum as attempts to concentrate power, to make it easier for a small number of people to say, mandate what to do. Actually, our purpose is to facilitate listening. Our new common curriculum will bring cohesiveness to all of our schools so that our teachers and instruction leaders can share a professional language. The citywide conversations that follow can develop the essential values of skills and skills that foster innovation and creativity. Within the classroom, we will have a common framework and teaching structures, but here again, we want greater structural similarity to support flexibility and adaptation. Teaching without identifying individual students' specific strengths and needs will be like running an emergency room by handing antibiotics to every patient who walks through the door. So imagine the man who comes into the emergency room complaining of chest pains, the girl's ankle turned purple after she tripped on the sidewalk, and the woman with fainting spells, all leaving with the same prescription for 2 weeks of penicillin. Far too long, many schools in this country have failed to see the individuality of the Asian student. Of the Asian students. Just as dangerous, notions about so-called model minorities can be used to excuse inadequate social and government support for Asian Americans. Unfounded assumptions about model students keep Asians from getting all the attention they deserve. A study by the Educational Testing Service shows enormous variation in Asian Americans' student performance, even within the same ethnic group. Clearly, teachers, like doctors, must analyze each case separately. One of the major emphases of our ambitious professional development efforts is training teachers to observe students individually and in small groups. We want them to look for patterns with each student what each student is doing well and what each student needs to do next. Teachers must adapt and individualize instruction. Again, it makes no sense to think everyone who comes to the hospital needs antibiotics, and it makes no sense to think to observe that a student is struggling if you do not also observe why is a student struggling. How can you build on what a student already knows about geometry to give him or her strategies to call on when his problem solving seems to be stuck? How can you look at a student's accomplishments as a reader to figure out what else, not just the class as a whole, should learn tomorrow? Teachers daily and close work with individuals and small groups also helps them know students better and listen to the best ways to address individual differences that arise from cultural dimensions. Consider the case of Huang Vinh, I don't know if I'm pronouncing this correct, an 18-year-old Vietnamese immigrant used as a case study in Sonia Nieto's important book, Affirming Diversity. A central educational belief in this country is that teachers must praise student accomplishment to build motivation. Vin finds such praise hollow and frustrating. He says, if my English is not so good, the teacher has to say, your English is not good. So you have to go home and study. And she tells me what to study and how to study to get better. But some Americans, you know, they don't understand about myself. So they just say, oh, you're doing a good job. You're doing great. Everything is great. Teachers talk like that. But my culture is different. They say, you have to do better. Realistically, we could not expect Vin's teacher to begin the year knowing that he equates being praised with being patronized. And if his teacher simply assumed many Vietnamese students share Vin's self-deprecating intensity, she would have misunderstood Vin's friend, Du, whom Vin says is smart and of good character, but also very lazy, and more interested in the mall than school. And since Vince absorbed his family's lesson about humility and self-reliance, we cannot expect him to tell his teacher directly that her compliments seem empty. What we can expect of being Vin's teacher is that she begins to observe Vin's reaction to her praise and to see what might affect him more. Such reactive teaching is possible even in New York City, where we have reduced average class size to less than 25 students in grades 4 to 9, but where some classrooms still hold as many as 32 students. When teachers spend less time at the front of a room and devote more time to sitting alongside students to observe and listen to them as they work, students do not have to hunt teachers down after school or during lunch to get individualized support. In a sense, that what can help students like Vin, whose brave independence makes him work incredibly hard, but who gets less out of school because, as he says, I don't want teachers to spend time about myself to help me. For teachers, the residue of knowing students' academic strengths and needs is knowing their strengths and needs as a people. Given the phenomenal cultural diversity in New York City classrooms, many teachers will never become experts in traditional Vietnamese values around education, or in how students like Vin and his friend Dewey reflect and reject them. But we can help teachers gain increasing expertise in Vin and Dewey as individuals. We can help teachers understand that Vin isn't just making coy conversation when he insists that his English is providing valuable information about his concerns as a learner, and he will not learn as much until he trusts his teachers take those concerns seriously. So I just mentioned traditional educational values. Here again, our teachers have to seek individuality, even as they look for broad understandings about culture. Of course, family and culture matter a great deal in educating students of Asian descent. I can't think of anyone who has grown up without some familial and cultural influence. But if we take too seriously what we often hear about how all Asian families demand good grades and quiet obedience from their children in school, then we begin to reduce expectations. Why take that extra effort to make sure that Indian student in Jackson Heights deeply understands a new algebra concept, if we're sure she'll make the extra effort herself when she goes home? Why call to get insights from that Korean mother in Flushing about her son's struggles as a writer, if we are sure she'll just defer silent to our authority? As educators, we must give Asian American students real opportunities to learn and to define themselves. I do not mean to belabor the marketing pitch for better luck for tomorrow, or better luck tomorrow, but it encapsulates so much of how this nation's wider culture sees Asian youngsters, a view that affects the climate in which they learn and grow. The film's website claims, everyone knows someone like Ben, the perfect Asian American high school teen. I'm sure many of you can imagine how constricting it must be perfect. And if you work so hard to uphold that impossible reputation for flawlessness, imagine how disheartening it must be to realize that perfection isn't special, that everyone knows someone just like you.